Hey guys, welcome to my channel. My name is Ritesh Kanji from Augmented Startups. And today I'm going to show you how you can enhance your chances of winning the OpenCV AI competition. So what exactly is the OpenCV AI competition? So from this website, which I'll have the link down below, it is an international AI competition that's celebrating OpenCV's 20th anniversary. As I've mentioned, it's hosted by OpenCV, but also sponsored by Microsoft and Intel, so you know it's legit. Over here, you can see there's prizes worth $400,000. That's a lot of cash. So you can see it's separated into global prizes as well as regional prizes. So in this video, I'm going to give you 5 tips on how you can enhance your chances of winning this competition. So this is whether you are already enrolled in the competition or you are wanting to join in the future. So let's get into tip number 1. Now, just a note, I've entered into this competition, so I've already submitted my topic just like many others. So if you have already enrolled in the competition and submitted your proposal, don't worry because there's more tips coming up. So you're probably asking yourself, what topics should I choose? There's an abundance of topics. I think a great place to start is here on the homepage where it says categories. So here it gives you some idea of what they are expecting. So their focus is also on helping people who are visually impaired. So for example, a device that helps people cross the street. You can also create an application for education, health and fitness. There's also agriculture for monitoring the health of plants. So depending on what point in the future you are watching this video, you can even cover COVID related applications, but just don't do social distancing and mass monitoring because that has been done throughout the internet. Like, I've also covered quite a few videos on this. If you have some background in robotics, you can also do something on robot navigation or SLAM. Any other topic that's not covered in these categories, then you can also come up with your own cool applications. Now you're probably asking yourself, okay, so I've got the categories. Now what topics do I choose? I recommend choosing something that will solve real world problems. And you're probably saying, okay, there's so much problems in the world. I just don't know which problem to zone in on. And this is where I got you covered. Okay, so to answer this question, basically take a look at your surroundings. So what problems do you face that you think you can potentially solve with computer vision? Or a special AI device like the OpenCV AI kit. So I recommend maybe taking a walk around your neighborhood or your community and just gain some perspective of what problems people are facing. I'll recommend jotting those down and then selecting the one that you are most passionate about. Okay, so next up, let's take a look at the winners from last year's OpenCV AI kit competition. So I'll have a link down to that below as well, but you can see what we have here. So the first prize winner was a vision system for the visually impaired. This was quite impressive. They have a couple of videos down here showing the applications of that. There's also a universal hand controller. Actually, let's just go down to see what we have here. So let's just move over to the demo. So this guy created like a vest with a waist harness that has the OpenCV AI kit. And let's look at the demo. So using the OpenCV AI kit, he is able to detect curb obstacles and other obstructions. So what's really cool is that this app will also describe his surroundings. Moving on to the next one, we have the universal hand controller. So this guy created an app which will allow you to create different gestures using your hands. And from what I've seen is that he can control his TV or use his hands as a TV remote. I find this really cool. Next, we also have parcel classification and dimensioning. This is really useful if you want to measure something without touching it, especially during the COVID era where you don't want to physically measure it with tape and that. You can just put an item down and it will automatically get those dimensions for you. Over here, they use the Oak for autonomous forklift. And then you also have a home workout assistant using pose estimation. The final one that we have here is an automatic lawnmower navigation. I really need this in my life. So from what I see is that this thing is doing obstacle avoidance and mapping out its environment so that it can mow the lawn in peace. You can think of it as a Roomba for your garden, but for cutting your lawn. Okay, that leads me to tip 2. So you're probably asking, how will my project be evaluated? And this leads me to the creativity of the problem. The panel wants to know, how useful is your application? So you can create this amazing application. Say for example, you have a tap in your house. You want to open the tap automatically when you come close to the tap or to the faucet. And then as you leave, it will switch off. This may or may not be that useful, but I mean, why use computer vision when you can use a simple IR LED to detect if your hands are under the faucet or not? It needs to be practical and useful in terms of how you apply the problem. Next, we move to novelty. How unique is your project? Are you creating something that has been done before? If so, can you make it open source? Or is your problem completely unique where you are solving a problem that hasn't been solved before? Those are the sort of questions that you need to ask yourself. How can I make this different from what's already been done out there? Next, we'll look at team qualifications. How qualified are your team? Are you students or are you a big established company? So maybe you have this elaborate plan to take over the world. To save the world. But now what the judges are looking for is, are you really able to execute the plan? Do you have the resources? Do you have the knowledge to take this concept forward from start to finish?
Mm-hmm. So in the first phase, we are looking at how useful the problem is, how novel the problem is, and looking at the team, can they execute the solution that they are claiming to execute, right? And of course, the quality of their proposal. It doesn't matter as much, but it does matter, whether they have explained the problem, given pictures and things like that, which affects the final judgment.
So this brings me to technical execution. If you look at the Apples, the Googles, and the Facebooks, they have almost unlimited resources when it comes to creating something for this type of competition. Now, what about people like you and me, where we have very limited resources? So maybe we are students or hobbyists, and we need to get to our solution. How do we get to that using our existing resources? So essentially, you'll be assessed on how resourceful you are in getting to your solution. Next, we have value to community. Does your application provide value to your community? And one way to do this is I recommend that you make your project open source if possible. Having it open source allows the community to join in and collaborate on your project, and it is more favorable to everyone.
Usefulness to the community, which is judged by whether you have open sourced your project or not. So you get a little bit dinged if your solution is completely closed source. That doesn't mean that you cannot win, but you get dinged for not open sourcing your solution.
And an example of that is some things are so novel, and just even like the fact that it proves that you can solve that sort of problem, like that a solution exists by them implementing it. So some things, even though they're not open source, but it's just so useful to know that's possible, could still be a really high score for value to the community, just because you're like, oh, okay, well, now I know that if I work in that direction, I'm not just gonna hit a dead end, right? Like they pulled it off, we probably can as well.
And then we have the final presentation. I recommend you make it as fun and as engaging as possible. Now, the panel doesn't expect you to be a professional video producer like me, but you need to have a compelling video that'll convince the judges as to why your application is good. So I want to emphasize that you should at least spend a decent amount of time on this. Okay, moving on to tip 3. Now, I'm not sure if you've heard of the term simple complexity. It's very easy for someone to make something complex, but it takes a lot of intelligence and genius to make something complex simple. Think about that. I think I probably got that from John Ive or some Apple design philosophy. So what I'm trying to say is that you can solve a problem by either going the very complex route or a very simple route. So I really want you to think about the technical depth that you want to go with regards to this project. Now, what the panel is also looking at is your technical depth. They want you to explore the full capability of the OakD device, especially the spatial AI side of things. So for one, you have 3 cameras. So you can do object detection on 2 of the cameras and fuse them together to have better accuracy. The other thing you can do is, as it implies, spatial awareness and get depth from your camera. So instead of just the x and y coordinates of your object, so you can also get depth, so the distance between your camera and the object that you're trying to detect.
When people receive their units, the generation one is still a lot easier to just like see what the device is capable, because there's just a bunch of examples in the depth.ai demo.py.
Now with Gen 2 just being released, you can do a multi-stage neural network, meaning that you can have one network just for detection and another network for recognition. There's a lot of possibilities that you can do with this. For example, license plate detection and recognition.
The generation two is then way more flexible when you actually go to program, which is then like really like the programmer's API, because it's like fundamentally infinite in terms of permutations of neural networks and other CV functions you can tie together. And is only only limited by resources come up on that. So that's one of the home run ones I would love to get to eventually, is taking advantage in not just training a 2D detector, but training a 3D detector straight up for better accuracy. Another one like that is actually improving depth perception. So you can use this to make better object detectors or better semantic segmenters. And that's what I just talked about. You can also use this to improve the quality of depth that you get. So you can make like a super depth sensor effectively, because you train the neural network to produce better depth results in conjunction with disparity depth. And then the other kind of like home run one that I think would be super cool, but all these like take more effort, would be training a multi-stage pipeline flow, where like maybe you train the first stage object detector and you also train like the second stage like image classifier.
That brings me to step four, how to train your own custom model. Now, a lot of people will be asking this question. You have this custom application and you want to train your own neural network for the OpenCV AI kit, as well as on how to deploy to this device. Now for this, I'd really recommend checking out Roboflow. Now, even though they are the sponsors of this channel, from what I've experienced with their workflow, it just makes things very easy. Now, if you've been following my channel, you've probably seen how easy it is to annotate your images, augment your dataset, train your model, and deploy it to the OpenCV AI kit. Let me show you a quick resource that you can check out. It's called blog.roboflow.com Luxonus OT custom model. And this post essentially shows you how to train your own sign language detector and deploy it to the OpenCV AI kit. You can see an example of it here. I will also have my own tutorial on this, on how to go from collecting your dataset to training it, deploying it, and running it on your OpenCV AI kit, on obviously with a Raspberry Pi attached to it. So I definitely recommend that you subscribe and click the bell icon so that you get notified of this tutorial when it comes out.
I think another useful question, I know it'll probably come up a lot, is how do I train the OpenCV AI kit? And I think that's where Joseph comes in the picture, where we use Roboflow for the training.
Yeah, I appreciate that. Yeah, I think the similar to the ethos of OpenCV and Luxonus with Oak, we aim to make it such that people can get started quickly, easily. Everything from basically collecting their data set to organizing and basically, you know, determining which images you even want to label and prepare and get ready, to labeling those images. And as you very much know, that part of the process also requires careful thought, you know, quality assurance of the annotations, making sure you have sufficient representation of classes and objects and things like this.
And that brings me to step number five. Where do you find help? Well, I recommend the best place to go when you're struggling or just need any type of information is to check out the Luxonus Discord community. And if you scroll down over here, you'll see something about the OpenCV AI kit competition. So any questions that you have, you can go straight here and the guys will really answer it within a day or two. I'll have the link to that down below. And a bonus tip that I recommend for all you guys entering the OpenCV AI competition is just to have fun. I mean, get out there, see how you can help people, as this will really enhance your expertise in computer vision and AI. Another bonus for you, let me show you a list of topics that you can check out. So for those of you who are struggling with coming up with a topic, here's a list of ideas for you. So what I want you to do is to look through each one of these topics and see how computer vision can be applied to each one of them, and then filter it by which one resonates the most with you. So that is it for this video. If you liked it, please like, share, and subscribe. Click that bell icon to get notified. Remember, I spoke to you about the upcoming video, which is on how to train your own sign language detector. You definitely don't want to miss it, especially if you are part of this competition. So as I've mentioned before, I'm also entering this competition. I submitted my topic. I can't tell you what it is right now, but I will in due time. I will be documenting my processes as well as my progress, and you can see that on Augmented Startups. Also, if you want to enroll in any one of our courses or join our membership, you can get access to source code, premium tutorials, and other courses just by enrolling down below. This is some really good coconut juice. Then, thank you for watching, and we'll see you in the next video.